Good morning. We're so glad you're here. My name is Deborah Rutter, and I have the world's best job of being the president of the Kennedy Center. And we're just thrilled to welcome you here for our first session today. We kicked it off last night, our sound health, and these two magnificent people will tell you a little bit about it. This partnership with the Kennedy Center and the National Institute of Health is perhaps one that some people would scratch their head a little bit about, but Francis and Renee and I have decided it's a match made in heaven, and we're loving it. Yeah. And I would also say that the National Endowment for the Arts has a really intensive program around music therapy in particular, but about the role of music in our lives. And I, who have known the National Endowment for the Arts for many decades, really have learned about a new aspect of their work, and this is really powerful work that they do across the country, and they've been a great partner for us as well. So welcome to this morning. I think you're going to find this fascinating. What I'd like to do now is introduce a woman who needs no introduction. If you don't know who Renee Fleming is, you don't deserve to be in this room. But I like to say that she's our dearest friend because she is an artistic advisor at large for the Kennedy Center. And Dr. Francis Collins, who is a musician. And on the side, he's also the director of the National Institute of Health.
Thank you, Deborah. Thank you. Oh. It's very exciting to have the resources of the Kennedy Center also to put on a couple of days like this. It's really the only place that can do it this way. How many of you were at the concert last night? Okay, so not fabulous. Thank you so much for, and you enjoyed it, obviously. Some of you weren't though, so let's just say that last night was a musical extravaganza and introduction to the breadth of this work. And I'd love to also say that it was a fantastic start, but Dr. Collins is going to talk for a second about what we did back in January.
So yeah, this is part of a larger effort, this collaboration that Renee and I cooked up and convinced all these other people to take part in. And thank you, Deborah, for putting the resources of the Kennedy Center in such a remarkable way at our disposal for this weekend. Yes, back in January, we held a workshop for 2 days on the NIH campus, and we invited neuroscientists who are studying how the brain works, and performers, and music therapists, and we all got together and for that day and a half tried to figure out what do we know and what would we like to know about how music and the brain interact, both in terms of the basic science, but also about how music can be used in healing ways, which is what music therapists do, and how could we use some of the new scientific discoveries to make that even better. And it was a wonderful day and a half, and we came up with a lot of ideas that NIH, as the largest supporter of biomedical research in the world, aims to try to pursue going forward with all of these partners. So it's an exciting sort of coming together in a way that makes life pretty interesting. So we had a great time, and this is another part of it, and there's more to come, but we aren't quite sure yet what it is.
Well, and these scientists all came from not just the US, but around the world, and they presented for us. I learned so much. It was an extraordinary workshop, and we are so fortunate to have five of them here. You're starting with Dr. Nina Kraus, who is focusing on childhood development. Now, I grew up in a musical household, as did Francis, as did Deborah. And there's no question that we've been formed by that. My dad is here, who was a high school vocal music teacher. My mom also did, and all of us in my family are somehow involved in music education, so I'm especially interested to hear what Dr. Kraus has to say. We also have Sherry Robb and DeForia Lane working with us on a presentation on music therapy, Ani Patel and creative aging. I will be there with bells on. And Dr. Charles Lim tonight with extraordinary Esperanza Spalding and Vijay Iyer about jazz improvisation and creative power and what that does for our brains. So this is a thrilling and growing field. So can you talk to us a little bit about our session later on today?
Well, right. So at 3:30 in the Millennium Stage, we're going to have a conversation, which is, I don't know where it's going to go. We're going to figure out. Renee is going to ask the questions, and I'm going to try to answer the ones that come to me. But the other person there is the former Surgeon General, Vivek Murthy, who's a very thoughtful physician who thinks a lot about how health and the mind work together and how meditation and other aspects of spirituality maybe should play a larger role in keeping us all healthy. So that's going to be a very interesting conversation. Come to that.
And for music therapy, did any of you see the Memorial Day concert last Sunday? Yeah. I was so moved, and Captain Luis Avila and his wife Claudia came last night and will be here for many of our events today as well. Incredible work. And we're introducing some other groups and some other extraordinary stories at Sherry Robb's event. And these sessions actually, in terms of improvement in all of these various therapies, just give us a taste of the breadth of what this work can do. Even the basic research, I think, is absolutely extraordinary. Can you tell us a little bit about the promise, what the future is for this field?
Well, that's going to be kind of up to all of us to invent. It's going to take, I think, the bringing together in even closer ways these wonderful disciplines of neuroscience, music therapy, and professional musicianship to see what we could learn about how to take the power of music and take it to the next level in terms of its healing opportunities. Each of you here sitting in the room, you've got 86 billion neurons between your ears. We're going to try to get a lot of them activated today in this workshop and the ones that follow. But we want to learn how to make the most of those circuits, those networks, which can be so powerful, to help people who are struggling with something like chronic pain or autism or Alzheimer's disease, and figure out how we can optimize what is already a very exciting field and see if we can both improve its likelihood of a good outcome and also understand why it doesn't always work the same way for every person. This is going to be a more precision approach, perhaps, to using music as healing than we've been able to do in the past. I'm very excited about all that.
Thank you.
So let's get started. Nina Kraus was so inspiring to me when I heard her in January at this workshop, and I think you will find her to share information that you probably thought you knew, but she's confirming a lot of it, and she has some very special guests. So enjoy. I hope you find the day inspiring. Thank you very much for being here. Nina Kraus.
Oh, thank you, and hello. It's really great to see you all. And so I get to talk about music and child development. And I'm from Northwestern University. Our lab is called Brain Volts. and I will be joined today by our wonderful musicians from the DC Youth Orchestra, Duncan, Anton, Lucy, and Amy. And they are going to be making comments throughout my presentation, and then they will have the last word because they will perform at the end of the show. So I get to talk about sound, and I'm a biologist, so it's how sound impacts our brain. And music turns out to be really powerful for communication and for brain health. Sound, music, and of course we're going to deal with this from a neuroscience perspective. The grass is moving. And making sense of sound is important for our survival. And you know, we need to be able to arbitrate. Is this something that we should be running towards or running away from? And it is an evolutionarily ancient part of our nervous system. It's also very important. Making sense of sound is how we learn, how we connect with each other. And we have to learn not only what to pay attention to, but we need to learn what sounds we need to ignore. So making sense of sound is very important for learning. So when you think about the attributes of a seen object, you know, I can describe this ball in terms of its shape and its color, its texture, and it's very concrete. You know, we live in a materialistic world. And I think that we don't realize how important sound is. Sound is invisible. sound like many of the world's most powerful forces, like magnetism, gravity. This force is invisible. And so I can describe a sound to you. I might say that it's dissonant and high-pitched. And, you know, you wouldn't know what I'm talking about. It's not like the ball. You know, I could be talking about brakes squealing or a piece of music or a bird squawking. But there are just as many ingredients in sound that our brain needs to figure out the meaning from. And this turns out to be one of the most complex and computationally delicate jobs that we ask our brain to do. So, you know, I think sound by its very nature is abstract. It moves in time, and it literally moves us. It's fleeting. I said it's invisible. And I think that this understatedness of sound, in a way, is why, you know, we have had a National Institute for Vision 20 years before we had one for hearing. Here's what happens when we make sense of sound. Sound has to enter our ears to our brain, and then there is a network of so many different processes and brain areas that we love to study as neuroscientists, and it affects and modulates what we hear by how we think about sound, how we feel about it, and how we move with it. You know, just the sound, the movement of my lips as I'm listening to my voice. This is very important, and we call this cognitive, sensory, motor, and reward networks, and they are all active while we're playing, while we are hearing. So, listen to this. Anybody hear a sentence there? Listen again.
The juice of lemons makes fine punch.
Okay, now listen to the first sentence again. Okay, do you believe me? Do you believe me that yes or no, how we think about sound influences how we hear it? Yeah. So, today I'm going to talk about how we are making sense of sound. I'll talk about our reward networks, our cognitive networks, and our sensory motor networks, and bring the science to you. Before, you know, of course, music is one of the most wonderful ways that we engage these cognitive, sensory motor, and reward networks. And so that is going to be the spotlight. Before I go any further, I would like to invite Amy to the stage. And I have asked each of our four student musicians to reflect on how has music helped you? How has music affected you in your daily life outside of music?
Outside of music, actually playing music has helped me a lot during my daily life. So I'm just going to go ahead and start by saying critical thinking skills. So when faced with a problem, because I play music, I'm not only looking for one solution to the problem, I also look for many different solutions that might be able to solve the same problem. Another thing that music helps me do during my daily life would be it's definitely improved my patience, and it's definitely improved the fact that I work hard. So music, you can't just expect to be a perfect violinist by practicing one day for 2 minutes. You have to work hard, and you have to have patience in order to achieve your goals. And this floods into my academics, too. You can't just expect to get a good grade. You have to work hard, and you have to be patient. And then finally, music has also helped me with meeting new friends and definitely, like, being able to contribute to different communities. And, like, my group back there, you know, Lucy, Duncan, and Anton, I'm so excited to see them every single Saturday, some Sundays, and sometimes even Wednesdays. We have so much fun all together. Thank you. Woo!
Beautiful. Amy, thank you so much. You know, what I was going to do, what I had planned when I had asked these questions, was that I was going to have each musician speak and talk about a particular aspect of the sensory, cognitive, and reward networks that I am going to be telling you about biologically. But each one has said that music impacts every single system. So what I love about my job is I get to learn every day, and I've already learned so much from Amy and Anton, and you will hear more from them in a minute. So I'm going to tell you a little bit about my own personal journey, which began with my mommy. So my mommy was an immigrant, and I was raised in a home where more than one language was spoken. My mommy was also a pianist, and I loved to play underneath the piano. I'd take my stuff and just kind of hang out underneath the piano because it felt good to be there. And I think that very early on, I must have realized that sound is important. And eventually, I became a biologist. And really, my job, I feel like my job is to take this biology and to harness that knowledge to inform communication health, communication through sound. So I started out counting hair cells in our ear, our cochlea. We have 30,000 specialized hair cells, and I was looking at them under a microscope, a phase contrast microscope. They were just beautiful, and counting them. And then I started working on an experiment recording from neurons in the eighth nerve of the chinchilla. I was studying something called two-tone suppression in the auditory nerve of the chinchilla. And this is where my mommy comes in again. And she says, Nina, what are you doing? And I realized at that moment, and this was decades ago, and it's informed my work ever since. I realized if I wasn't doing something that I could explain to my mommy, I didn't want to be doing that thing. And so, I still was sticking needles into neurons, and I decided I was going to see, so what happens if you take an animal, at that time I was using the rabbit model, and you record from a neuron and you play a sound. Now you teach the animal that the sound has meaning. Turns out that the cells respond differently to that same sound. The sound hasn't changed, but the nervous system has changed. And this is what happens when we practice things again and again and again and again. The nervous system changes, and so I was able to see firsthand, I was able to look at learning firsthand in a neuron. But I was motivated, always motivated, and we still have an animal model in my lab, but the work is motivated to affect human health. One of the things that I learned is that music is a fabulous model for learning through sound. But importantly, through my work, it's really been guided by wanting to have the granularity, the precision that we can have in single neuron experiments in animal models, because we have the precision and the beauty of neuroscience insights, and we should be able to apply these to humans. So finally, I discovered that I could apply something called the frequency following response. This is me being very happy, swinging over the road over our house. And because finally, this is a way of measuring sound processing in the brain that gives us the kind of granularity that really approaches what we can see when we record from single neurons in animal models. So, as I'm talking to you now, the nerves in your brain are responding to the sound of my voice, and they're producing electricity. And in the same way as I can take the sound from my electric guitar and feed it through a speaker, and we can hear it, I can take the electricity from your brain, and we can hear that. So here is a speech sound. And here is your brain's response to that sound. Okay, now, you know, this is usually when you're looking at a brain response to something, it doesn't look anything like the stimulus that was used to stimulate the brain. But you can see that they physically look similar and sound similar, so that gives us a lot to work with. Here's some more examples, some high pitch.
Stop.
Asking a question.
Stop.
A bassoon. You'll hear a scale and the brain's response to the scale. Little Mozart, and the brain will take it from there. And my absolute favorite. You will hear more Deep Purple later on. Okay, so what we can do is I can pick up that electrical activity from your brain, and now we can figure out how good a job your brain is doing at processing those individual ingredients. Now, Dr. Collins said we wanted to look at individuals, and this is really a new frontier in neuroscience, because each one of us, our life in sound, influences how we perceive sound, how you are listening to what I'm saying right now. And we are all individuals, and we need to be able to understand individuals if we're really going to affect communication and health. So an expert system might look like this. A child with a language disorder might have a profile that looks like this. But I'd like you to hear, so this is an expert system might sound like this.
This is a top to a, you know, what we use on stage, but it's very, very special because if you can see,
yeah,
the numbers all go to 11.
What's this from? Yeah. A plus. But a disordered system might hear it like this.
This is a top to a, you know, what we use on stage, but it's very, very special because if you can see,
yeah,
the numbers all go to 11.
So if your brain is hearing in this manner, how are you to learn? So sound is invisible, and it is our ally. It is also our enemy. The sounds of our lives shape our brain. I like to say our past shapes our present. So it reflects our past, and it predicts our future. The way our brain responds to sound today will predict what we can do with it later on. So it's a form of biological sound, of biological time travel. So if we look at the expert system, today we'll be focusing on playing musical instruments and singing, making music. And the enemies that I'm going to talk about are language disorders, noise, and head injury. So starting first just with noise, what I'm talking about in terms of noise here, this is the noise in our environment. These are so-called safe level noise. This is not noise that's loud enough to give you a hearing loss. This is, you know, the garbage trucks, the beeping that wakes us up in the morning, the traffic, the air conditioning. I mean, even in this room, you know, if we were to turn off the lights, it would be quieter. It turns out that this moderate level sound affects our health. This noise increases our stress, our distractibility, it disrupts our sleep, it promotes hypertension, and it disrupts our development and our ability to think. So, in animal models again, we know that meaningless noise, if you take kittens and you just have them listen. You subject them to meaningless noise for many hours in the day. What happens is that this usual beautiful precision with which the brain is organized, kind of like a piano, becomes disrupted. So, I mean, imagine, think about this. You know, a baby, a child cannot help but learn a language. A child cannot help but make meaning out of sound. And now, if you give that developing system meaningless sound, it's going to try to make sense of it. And it's going to disrupt and blunt the system in the process. So, you know, we have to stop being so cavalier about sound and really notice its impact on us and on our development. And, you know, I think that many parents these days are using white noise machines to kind of keep their babies asleep. It might be something to think about. Maybe not the best thing. Head injury. Another way in which making sense of sound is disrupted. So if you think that making sense of sound is one of the most complex jobs that we ask our brains to do, of course, if you get hit in the head, it's going to disrupt this process. And the kind of process, you know what, I say, okay, this is a computationally difficult job. We're talking about microsecond processing of action potentials. Neurons take a half a millisecond to respond. We are looking at microsecond timing and precision that our brain has to do when we tell it, do some math and figure out what instrument is playing over there in amidst other instruments and where in space is it. So this kind of computation, you know, sound processing is very much faster, 40 times faster than visual processing. So it can be disrupted with head injury. And what we've discovered, and this was really on the strength of, okay, sound processing is one of the most complex things we ask our brains to do. It is likely to be disrupted. This was our hypothesis. But also, people with head injury complain about the ability of the difficulty making sense of sound in complicated places. So we've discovered that sound processing in the brain can be a biological marker. We've done this in children, children athletes, and also with Northwestern athletes, Northwestern football players. And what we have learned is that our biological marker, this is just measuring the details of sound processing in the brain. Again, you know, this mixing board analogy that I have, there is a very specific signature for concussion. And it tracks with concussion severity. It monitors recovery. You know, we need to know when athletes are healthy enough to get back into play, when their brains are ready. And there is a legacy sometimes associated with previous concussions. And we can see this. We can see this, we can understand this biologically. This is a way that we can affect human health through sound. Now, our Renee Fleming sang at the Memorial Day concert, and this was really such a beautiful moment for really thinking about how music and music therapy can help us combat head injury and help us to bring people who have had head insults into recovery. And so the field of music therapy is one that people have applied to this task, but there really is not that much that is, we stand to learn so much more about how we might be able to harness the power of music to be able to help us heal. And I really put to you that what we need here are uniform and rigorous biological outcomes You know, the kind that I'm talking to you about today, where, you know, a couple of electrodes, you figure out how individuals are processing sound, and you see how that individual has been impacted by a head injury, and see how, with therapy, how music, what courses of music for an individual might be the best course of treatment. So this is for the future. Okay, so, you know, I talked about cognitive, sensory, and reward systems. And music is the jackpot. Music is really the jackpot because it engages all of these systems in a way that, I mean, I really can't think of other auditory functions. So I think it's Anton's turn to come up and tell us a little bit. About what music has meant for him outside of music, outside of the beauty, the wonder of making music. How has music helped you in your daily life?
Well, music, firstly, it makes me a lot more patient with people, because I'm not really that patient. If I get angry, it's like comes really fast. But music helps me kind of cool down a little and lets me, like, think about what I'm doing. Then helps me with school, I guess, because, you know, just helps me focus with doing my work in school. Helps me get better grades, I guess.
I think that's a lot. That is a huge lot. And, you know, as we're listening here, folks in the Department of Education who can think about how, you know, music education is really a part of every child's, or should be a part of every child's education, not only because they are making music, but because they may do better in school. And let's see what the science has to say about this. So why might making music enhance non-musical skills? So Ani Patel, who will be speaking later on today, has an opera hypothesis. And, you know, he talks about the O in opera, the overlap between the sounds and the nervous system that is involved, for example, in speech and music. Precision. So the precision that is required for making music is higher than what we demand for speech. Because imagine, you know, I can understand you if you speak with a foreign accent. I can understand you through a crummy cell phone connection. But a tiny change in the timing or in the pitch of music will really affect the musicality. So the precision is important. Emotion. So we know, again, from rigorous animal models that animals learn sound to meaning tasks. They learn tasks much faster and they remember much longer if you stimulate the emotional systems in the brain while they are learning. And we know this intuitively. We learn what we care about. Repetition. Amy, I think you said you have to do things again and again and again. And one of the things that we also will learn and see biologically is the brain doesn't change in 5 minutes. You have to do things again and again if you're going to really change the nervous system. And importantly, attention. So we have to learn what to pay attention to. And I like to, so my husband's a musician. And the other day I was learning a Dire Straits lick. And he came by and he said, you know, Nina, if you would listen, you would hear that when he's playing those four notes very quickly, he's not using his pick, he's pulling off the strings on his left hand. Well, you know, that has a certain sound to it. Before he pointed that out, I was deaf to it. But now, It's a very characteristic sound. I hear it, I know what to do, but I had to learn what to pay attention to, and that's really, really important. We have to learn how to pay attention to sound very actively, as we do with our music, in order for it to become automatic. Okay, so cognitive. I'm going to talk about neuroscience, what music helps us do in terms of our cognitive skills, focusing on attention and auditory working memory. So, attention. Attention, what you need to do every time you hear a note, I need you to, as quickly as possible, raise your hand. And every time you hear a distractor, don't raise your hand. So, and raise your hand and then put it down again. Good job. Okay, now we're going to play this game, and you have to do it as quickly as you can, and try not to flinch when you're not supposed to move, okay? So this is the kind of test that we can do in a laboratory. And we can test people's auditory attention skills, and the tasks become more complicated than this. But you can just see how this very basic task and inhibiting, and especially one of the things we've learned is that drummers are especially good at inhibiting other sounds. So in a number of neuroscience experiments, what we have been able to show is that attention skills, tested in a typical standardized way, is simply better in people who play music. And what do I mean by a musician? Because I'm going to be showing you data from musicians. I'm not talking about professional musicians. I'm talking about even hack musicians like me, someone who regularly plays a musical instrument throughout their lives. So I want to talk about music and hearing a noise. So, I was really thinking about this last night with Edwin, our conductor. The conductor has the biggest brain. He has to listen to all the different sounds of all the instruments in the orchestra. And he needs to be able to pull out what is signal, what is noise, in a very, very complex soundscape. And so we wondered, well, if musicians have to do this, would that help in speech? Would it help us understand our friend's voice in a noisy restaurant? Would it help a kid understand their friend on a playground? And so, I want you to listen to this sentence and see if you can tell me what it says. Okay, listen to this.
Sugar is very sweet.
Do you get it? Okay. So these are these are tests, standardized tests. They were not developed by us. These are standardized tests that are used to measure hearing and noise. And what is wonderful is that it actually turns out that across the lifespan, people with musical experience, people who make music, are better able to hear speech in noise. So this is a transfer from music to speech. And I'm going to nip this question right now because I get it all the time. People are going to say, oh, well, I listen to music. Is that going to help me in this kind of a situation? And people listen to music all the time. But I like to say, you're not going to get physically fit watching sports. You have to make the music. And again, what is so beautiful here, looking at speech and noise and the brain's response to it, is you can see it objectively in the biology. I love thinking about these really complicated questions like, why does music make us feel so? But I work with signals. I work with sound waves and brain waves, voltages, patterns, and it's so encouraging and comforting, calming for me to be seeing, look, here's a musician's response in quiet and in noise. You can see that in noise, the noise hasn't really affected the response very much at all. But for the non-musician, it's very obvious that the non-musician, when he's listening to a signal in noise, that signal processing has been deeply affected. So reverberation is something that affects our ability to hear. So listen to typical sentence.
Many factors influence speech intelligibility.
Now let's hear it reverberated.
Many factors influence speech intelligibility.
So everyone is affected by reverberation. You know, say you're in a train station or... and again, musicians simply are better at hearing speech and noise in challenging listening environments. This is important. This is important because, I mean, imagine any time you're listening to somebody and it's noisy, if you're struggling to figure out what is being said, you don't have much time to think about what people are saying. But if your brain is this fabulous system that enables you to hear what is being said, clearly, you can be steps ahead of everyone else, because you can be thinking about, okay, well, you know, what is that person, how can I think about what that person just said? Okay, so auditory working memory, this is another cognitive function that affects our, impacted by music. So, you know, just think about, so as I'm talking to you now, you have to remember what I just said in order to make sense of what I'm saying in this moment. That's your auditory working memory. To tune your instrument, you have to remember the sound of the note to tune your instrument. If I'm going to improvise on your musical idea, I have to remember your musical idea if I'm going to improvise on it. That's my auditory working memory. As musicians, we use our auditory working memory all the time. And again, in standardized tests, I can do something like give you a shopping list and then have you, I can tell you a bunch of items and have you remember, just tell me which items were produce that started with the letter B. So you have this whole list that I've told you, and then you have to work your memory and come back and tell me what it is that you heard. So I'm going to show you a personal example of me using my auditory working memory, trying to learn a Chuck Berry lick. And, you know, I'll be listening to Chuck, and then, of course, I'll forget, and I'll have to listen again, and I'll forget again. But hopefully during that time, I am strengthening my auditory working memory. It's very obvious when Chuck is playing. Take N again and again and again and again. But again, in these laboratory experiments, what we know is that musicians are simply better at tests of auditory working memory. So this is important for learning. Lucy. Lucy, how has music influenced you in your daily life?
So music has influenced me in many ways. It has given me a lot of life skills and things that help me throughout life, like perseverance. So music doesn't always come naturally. You have to practice and practice until it is good. And perseverance is a very good skill for that, because you need a lot of perseverance in music. You need it to help you to become a musician. And music is another language, and it's a It's a language that only musicians speak between each other. And when you're playing with somebody, you're speaking another language. Some people don't think of music as a language, but musicians always have that feeling that they know another language. And the spirit of music is always enjoyable, and I always have a great time playing with my friends. Thank you.
Thank you, Lucy. So you know, what you guys don't know, we reviewed some of these comments ahead of the show, and what I'm hearing from everyone, every musician, is you're improvising. You're saying different things now than you said earlier, which is why we go to a performance. You know, it's a performance. And, you know, sometimes it goes well, sometimes it doesn't so well, but, you know, it's live, and you can improvise, and thank you so much. Okay, so I'm going to talk about how language and music coincide. And biologically, again, I want to say that the same aspects of sound processing in the brain, the particular aspects of sound that we need to be strengthened in order to develop language and to read, are those aspects of sound processing that are strengthened by making music. It's rather remarkable. These neural signatures really coincide. So how do we know this? We've done a series of projects, cross-sectional projects, but these are longitudinal projects, and where we have followed kids in Chicago high schools and kids in the gang reduction zones of Los Angeles, and we followed them longitudinally, and the long and longitudinal is no joke, because we follow them year after year after year. Kids who were playing music had music as a part of their regular curriculum, and kids who were doing another form of an enrichment activity. And one of the things that, first of all, The founders of these programs, they came to me and they said, Nina, you know, we already know that the kids who are playing music are the better students. But what's going on in their brains? And so we tried to address this. And one of the things you should know is these schools are all in low-income neighborhoods. And one of the things that is often associated with poverty, with low-income neighborhoods, is linguistic deprivation. And it is typically measured, the measure that, again, others have come up with, it's indexed by maternal education. And there is something called the 30 million word gap, by which children whose moms have less education are likely to hear 30 million fewer words by the time they're 5 years old than a child whose mom has more education. And of course, there are many, many exceptions. I always feel strange saying this, but this is the proxy for linguistic deprivation that is standard in the field. So what we did is we took these high school kids and all families, 95%, more than 95% of the families qualified for subsidized lunch, and we divided the kids that were educated in the same classrooms, same schools, divided them simply on their mom's education. And what we found was that the kids whose moms had less education, they had more neural noise. So their nervous system was producing noise. Also, we found that some of the ingredients of sound processing in the brain, some of the ones that we know are important for language, that these were diminished. So the analogy that I think works really well here is, imagine you're listening to the radio, and on the one hand, there's static on the radio. So there's static, and on top of that, your mouse's voice is quite awful. If this is the way you're hearing in a classroom, how are you to learn? So what we found was that there really is a biological signature for linguistic deprivation. And what we found across these studies is that music won't fix the problem entirely, but it will offset it. It has a significant impact. So this is very important as we think about education. We also know that the achievement gap is something that increases as years go on in school, especially in low-income schools and neighborhoods. And one of the things that we discovered is that the kids who played music, they didn't show that decrease in reading year after year. They maintained their reading scores. We saw this both in grammar schools in LA and in high schools in Chicago. So we saw this for standardized measures of reading. We saw this, again, for standardized measures of listening in noise. And importantly, we looked at brain development. I mean, we were able to look at neural responses to sound 4 years in a row in individual children. And we were able to see that with music making, the children had faster brain development, and again, that their precision of sound processing just simply was better. Importantly, very importantly, after 1 year of making music in both the grammar schools and in the high schools, we saw no evidence of biological changes. It was only after 2 years, in both sets of studies, did these changes start to emerge, which speaks to the fact that you have to do things again and again and again to learn them if you are going to be a musician. And your brain, fortunately, our brain does not change every second, because, you know, it would be a very confusing world if it did. So in order to fundamentally change the default state, the way that I'm walking in here and I am listening to whatever sounds are around me, this is based on my life in sound, and certainly in terms of the education, the music education, at least it took us 2 years to see very, very objective changes in brain function. And importantly, it has a lifelong impact. So how many of you have played music at some time in your life? How many of you are still playing now? Yeah, most, there are many, many people, you know, often people will play music for some time and then they will stop. And importantly, and this is, again, so important educationally to understand, that this has a lifelong impact, that, and again, we have been able to demonstrate this biologically and objectively, that people who have had musical education in their past, and now we're testing somebody when they're 70, 80 years old, and they haven't played music for decades, yet the people who played music have sound processing in the brain for language. You know, they're better able to hear speech and noise, one of the biggest complaints as we get older. So this has a lifelong impact. It's not about, you know, people will say, oh, I don't care if my son becomes a violinist. But you may care that your child does well in life and is able to communicate as well as they possibly can until they die. So I'm often asked, you know, well, what about, does it matter what instrument you play, if it's an instrument or if you sing? Does it matter if you sight read to learn or if you improvise? And again, across all of our studies and studies from other labs, it really doesn't matter. What is important is to be making sound to meaning connections through music. This is what is important. I have to say that the musicians that we have tested who can both sight read and improvise are the most flexible in terms of some of the brain processes that we see. But again, you know, this is an area that needs to be investigated further. I can also tell you that there is specialization of the specialized. If you're a bassoon player, you're very, very tuned to the sound of a bassoon. But in terms of the fundamental ways in which our brain changes, in ways that helps us for language and communication, it really doesn't matter how you get to it. So, sensory motor. Speaking, rhythm is going to be a big deal here. So, there is rhythm in music, you all know that. But you probably don't realize how much rhythm there is in speech. Rhythm helps us understand where important things stop and start in speech. Here's, I think, a really good illustration.
Mr. Walker, I am extraordinarily busy, sir. I just wanted to ask about the chocolate. The lifetime supply of chocolate for Charlie. Well, when does he get it?
He doesn't.
Why not?
Because he broke the rules.
What rules? We didn't say any rules, did we, Charlie?
Wrong, sir. Wrong.
Under Section 37B of the contract signed by him, it states quite clearly that all offers shall become null and void if, and you can read it for yourself in his photostatic copy, I, the undersigned, shall forfeit all rights, privileges, and licenses herein and herein contained, etc., etc., fax mendis, incendium gloria calpum, etc., etc., memo bis punitor delicatum. It's all there, black and white, clear as crystal. You stole fizzy lifting drinks. You bumped into the ceiling, which now has to be washed and sterilized, so you get nothing. You lose. Good day, sir.
You're a crook. You're a cheat and a swindler. That's what you are. How can you do a thing like this? Build up a little boy's hopes and then smash all his dreams to pieces. You're an inhuman monster.
I said good day.
Okay. So there is rhythm in speech, and there is neuroscience that shows that better language skills are associated with better rhythm skills. And also some kids who have difficulty learning to read, for example, have some difficulty with rhythm skills. This is some research that we've done with three-year-olds, where we've had them tap along to a beat. So he's tapping along to a steady beat, and here the steady beat is going on, and the kid is tapping along. So, you know, he's enthusiastic. But what is interesting here is, again, so you can see the rhythm in the sound wave. And you can see that the brain is following those rhythms in the kids who are the synchronizers. And they do not follow those rhythms in the kids who have not learned to synchronize well. So, you know, this is a very important point that I think really helps us think about the fact that we may want to, I mean, how important it is to bring rhythm and bring music into education for language. And when we think about rhythm, you know, this is one more example of how I have been wrong. You know, I have these hypotheses all the time, and I'm so often wrong. You know, I thought that if you were good at one kind of rhythm, you'd be good at other kinds of rhythm. You'd just be good at rhythm. Wrong. So if you are good at following along with the beat, you know, so I'm going da 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 da, then I have you do something like right. So that's your ability to follow a rhythm sequence. And the rhythm sequence follows the notes, and it also follows the words. And it turns out that people, and we've looked at this in three-year-olds, we've looked at this in adolescents, where we could really do a lot of rhythmic tests on them, we see that the kids who are better at beat skills are not the kids who are better at sequence skills. And there is just really no relationship, and that there are different neural processes associated with each kind of rhythm. And these are just two of many kinds of rhythms that we can study. So again, there's a lot to learn here. Again, rhythm training. Duncan. Dear Duncan, what has music done for you?
So, hi, my name is Duncan. First of all, please don't stare at that photo. I know it doesn't look right. So I picked up violin when I was 4 years old, and ever since then, I've built so many skills in my life that it's just unbelievable how it's impacted me, and it's, you know, brought me life skills and even a couple of applauses. Like, who wouldn't want that? Like, at the end, it's really worth it. And like we're talking about here today, about sound and how it really impacts us, one of the great things about being a musician for the long time is you pick up, like, songs you hear on the radio, like Michael Jackson or even Justin Bieber, I don't know. You get to just, you know, let the music take over and just feel it, and you just play it. Like, you don't even, you know what's going on, but it's just unbelievable how powerful the music really is. And it's so calming as well. Like, you know, some stuff that's going on in a society today, like, that calms you. It definitely calms you. It takes over your body, and it's amazing how powerful it is. And everybody in this room, whether you have one or not, can pick up an instrument or any general art or music, a type of music at all. And everybody in this room is worth an instrument and can do it, because we humans were born with the skill to do something else than just, you know. But yeah, music has definitely impacted me from my sleeping to waking up, even school, because middle school is pretty boring, I'll tell you that. But even now, when you're so used to playing violin so much, I take a pencil and, you know, like, rub it on my arm just to pretend to play violin, because I don't know if it helps or not, but I definitely play better when I get home from school. But it's just, it's really worth it, because music, it brings you a gift, and that's not a gift that everybody can have. And that's why I encourage everyone to pick up something that they love, and love family members, encourage the ones you love to pick up something they love, because it's a life-changing experience. Even if you don't have it forever, it will stick with you in your heart forever. So that's how music changed me.
You heard it here. So, you know, there's the science, there's the practice. So let's talk about reward, so how we feel. Music really helps us connect. I want you to look at these babies and see, when the music starts, how they engage with each other.
Hi, girls. It's August 6th. Is that right?
Yeah.
August 6, 2012. Daddy's gonna play them a little song while they're eating their peas.
You girls ready?
So music connects us, and some experiments that Laurel Trainer and her group have done, she has shown how if you move in synchrony with another person, you are more likely to like them, and you are more likely to help them. I want to show you some pictures here and a video.
Thank you.
there. Oh, no. Oopsie. Uh-oh. Oh, no.
So music connects us. And one of the things that Renee has told me is that there are certain pieces of music that are universal in that she can sing them all over the world and people will respond. And that's really just something to think about and something we have a lot to learn from. But there is an example that really spoke to me that I wanted to share with you. So, you know, these guys. I invite you to watch this whole thing on when they start singing. It's wonderful, just wonderful. So music connects us. Music connects us no matter who we are or where we're from. And music is something that stimulates our emotional systems. And our emotional systems in our brain, our limbic systems, are the most evolutionarily ancient. They're the ones that are associated with how we feel when we're hungry, when we're bonding with people. It's important for very, very basic biological functions. And music excites the limbic system, whether we're happy, we're sad, whether we're encouraged, whether we're feeling calm. And we know that chemicals, hormones such as oxytocin, chemicals such as dopamine, neurotransmitters, will be flowing in our limbic system while we're listening to music, while we're anticipating a certain part of the piece. Other parts of the limbic system will be releasing dopamine at the musical climax. And so we are awash with chemicals that move us when we are listening to music. And so these are my babies. These are my three babies. And you know how when people say to you, it's so good to hear the sound of your voice? It's that emotion, it's that connection that we have had for years and years and years. And so, we wondered whether if you had musical experience, if you play an instrument, would your brain be better able to pick up on the nuances of emotion? So here is a baby crying. And what we can see here is that this is the emotional part with the rectangle, the emotional part of the baby crying. You know, and all of you have heard baby cries, and you know when the baby means it and when he doesn't. That is the part that tells you whether he's serious. and musicians, again, automatically, just automatically, without thinking, in their sleep, a parent who plays music is able to know, I better get up, or eh. And the non-musician is actually responding more vigorously to the simple acoustical part of that baby cry, because that's the only part that the non-musician will respond to. So he's holding on to that for dear life. So I'm gonna wrap some things up here. I hope that I have convinced you that sound is biologically powerful. It is our invisible ally and enemy. And it has a profound impact. Music has a profound impact on our brain. It has a profound impact on child development, on development of language skills, on our emotional health, on our social bonding. And importantly, making music has lasting effects within an individual. I want you to think about, so when we think about time and we think about evolution, you know, I can't even think in terms of the millennia because I'm thinking in microseconds every day. But, you know, each one of us has a lifetime. And during that lifetime, what we do, I like to say that biologically we are what we do and that our past shapes our present. And that what we do will have a lasting effect. What we do early in life has a lasting effect later. So, you know, I think it really makes it very important for us to think about how we can best engage music to strengthen human communication and brain health. And certainly as a biologist, you know, I'm teeming with ideas. I know you have many, many questions. There are so many questions that just beg for some knowledge. And one of the things I love about being a biologist is, you know, we know so little about the brain. And there is so much to challenge us and to think about. And I know we'll never understand it all. I'm completely comfortable with that. And but there are really good reasons to understand musical impact on the nervous system. And I think that it's important to use the biology, so that we can have uniform and objective, ironclad outcomes to measure how we can best learn, how can we best learn language, how can we best deal with head injury, how can we best learn a musical instrument, what are various therapeutic approaches that can help us with all kinds of aspects of brain health, really having an objective way of looking at these outcomes in a way that reflects the health of individual people personally is, I think, a beautiful frontier for us to look ahead to. I want to acknowledge, these are the people in my lab, Brain Vaults in particular, Trent Nickel, Jen Krisman, and Travis White Schwach, who have been with me from 25 years, and so, you know, this is really a group of people who I'm so fortunate to work with, graduate students and postdocs. And I want to invite you, please, to visit our magical website, which, and I have little cards here if you want them, but it's really, it's a labor of love, and we really work hard to try to take like all of the information that I've talked to you about today and to put it in a form where you can grab it and you can use it to affect whatever policy you might want to be affecting, whether it's in your home or in your country. And also you can see the demonstration of our biological approach there. But I encourage you on each one of those topics to start with, there's a overview slideshow that shows you a picture, a line of text that summarizes 2 years of work, and you can just sort of get an overview, and then from there you can go as deeply as possible. So I thank you very much, and I would like to at this point Let me see. I have just, like, maybe I can take one question or so. Meanwhile, maybe our DC Youth Orchestra can start setting up. And they are going to be playing for us the Telemann Concerto for four violins in G major. Question. Yeah, is there a special phase, is a special time in a child's life when they should begin music? At any time. And also, you know, we are never too, we know from animal experiments that the nervous system and learning through sound, we are never too old to learn. And with children, you know, whenever you can. You know, people often want to have dosage effects and, you know, at what year should I start? It's really, you know, it's a one-to-one situation. Certainly early, and living in a household that has a lot of music is start at birth. Start while you're carrying your babies and sing to them and move so that they can feel, you know, the rhythms. So at any time. Another question? Yeah, you. Yeah. So people are always asking, you know, dosage effects, and we don't know, and you know, again, this is something that we're going to need to learn. We've established some effects here, and I can tell you that in the studies that we have done, the students have had roughly 4 to 5 hours of music a week, of some kind of instruction. And again, the instruction has really, we have looked at two different models. One is through Chicago Public Schools, and the other is, so that's taught by music teachers. And then in the Harmony Project in LA, that was taught by musicians after school. So, you know, different models. But, you know, again, I think we need to use our common sense to informed by the science, as we learn more and more, that we need to, anything that is worth doing is going to take some time. And so playing as much as you possibly can and having as much instruction as a district can afford, and then, you know, it's impossible to control for how much were the kids playing at home or not, but in general, a few hours a week of music, that sounds heavenly. Any other? Speak up.
I work in the craniofacial molecular biology lab, but I'm educated. I'm trying to figure it out. If a person lost a hearing due to oral cancer, so on and so forth, will the things that you describe, that kind of social bounding connectivity, still live with you?
Yes. So the question, what about if you lose your hearing? And so think about Beethoven. Beethoven was deaf, and he played some of the most wonderful music we've had the privilege to hear. So much of music happens in our heads. We know that also people with hearing loss, you know, and as we get older, music, people who play music still have sound processing in the brain that is stronger, and auditory working memory skills that are stronger than older adults who have normal hearing, even if you're comparing a musician with a hearing loss. So a musician with a hearing loss will be able to actually make more sense out of sound than someone who is not a musician and has normal hearing thresholds. So it really speaks to the fact that hearing happens in our brains.
Gentlemen, the DC Youth Orchestra, come take a bow. I understand the four of them have their own musical group. What is it called?
The Schnurbles.
The Schnurbles. Look out for them. Thank you. Thank you very much.